सांसों की जरूरत है जैसे जिंदगी के लिए बस एक सनम चाहिए आशिकी के लिए.
Rahul Roy sir, a man who needs no introduction. For me, it's a bit of a surreal feeling to be seeing you after so many years. So much of the name Rahul Roy, when we hear it, it evokes so many memories for a generation of people. Some people may hear the opening strands of Saanson Ki Zarurat Hai Jaise. Somebody might hear a song from another film. Some people might see the hair, which you still have that hairstyle. What do you remember of just that wave post the release of Aashiqui?
Jimmy, you know, everybody, it's a nice question that you've asked, because, you know, everybody asks very different kind that, you know, when you were superstar, jab aap the, to aapko kaisa laga, aisa kaisa laga, wagaire. You know, I was already modeling, I was already, you know, because of my parents, you know, since the age of 12, I'd already traveled. So, unfortunately, I don't have a story which is like, you know, that I came from extremely humble background or anything. I came from a upper middle class. My parents had provided well. But I didn't honestly know what to expect from the film. I didn't know what kind of reaction people. In fact, you know, obviously you were very young, but, you know, the thing is that everybody loved the movie. Of course, the music was already a very big thing. But, you know, they quite, nobody gave me a reassuring thing that, you know, you could succeed as a hero just before the release of the film. There were these huge question marks. I mean, Bhatshab and all wanted to, obviously. But nobody could give that, you know, despite their years of experience and everything. Nobody could tell me that you're going to work because of the simple fact that I was very unconventional looking, you know, compared to what the other heroes, you know, that came out from a factory kind of a thing. So I honestly didn't, and I was really not been given very encouraging things, you know, that his hair is too long, he wears very baggy kind of clothes, he's very unconventional, this is not going to work in Hindi films. But, you know, when the film did release on 17th of August and I've gone to Metro at 12 o'clock of the day, when Mukherjee, wow, I saw the reaction of the public and how they went crazy throwing the coins, and they recognized me and they had accepted. So I remember my telephone call, because there were no mobiles, so it was a landline. I spoke to Bhatshab. I profusely thanked him. I said, you know, I've arrived. Now let the naysayers claim whatever, let them say whatever. I too don't know anything about the film industry. Because I'm new, and I don't say this with arrogance, but I knew something inside. Nobody knows what's going to work. Nobody knows in the industry what's going to work, and that stands true even now in 2020. Nobody knows. You can just go and try and make the best project possible. You've got to believe in it. You've got to have faith in it. You can only make a good project, nothing else. So the kind of fan following that arose from that film was unbelievable. Firstly, you know, because I've never reacted like that. I've not been a fan of anybody and reacted in such a way. But, you know, starting with the thousands of letters coming every day, those days there were no emails or social media. So, you know, letters used to come, the conventional. And the kind of stuff that used to come in the mail, it was unreal. You know, the girls' undergarments, letters written in blood were very common. Now, you know, I used to get them, and the postman used to come with gunny sacks filled with letters and used to leave it at my PG. And sadly, there was no way that I could read all of them, because there were just too many of them. And whatever I could take care of, I did. But I immediately got into a lot of films, because in those years, we didn't have, you know, that we have a whole toolie of people. Somebody's handling your contract, somebody's handling it. There's nothing
right,
like that.
Right.
Your dad has been working much before, you know, like. So those days, there was a story narrated, and we just went on gut instinct that, you know, this guy will hopefully make a good film. Because all of us at that time wanted to be part of good films. you know, and starting even from scratch, like, okay, there's a story, you know who else is there. So, you know, after 6 months of waiting, despite Ashiki doing very well, people were trying to place that, you know, how to place this hero, because, you know, he doesn't look like the poor boy loving the rich girl, because that was the formula that used to work. So I looked at everything else. So it took them 6 months, and then in 11 days, I signed 49 films. So, you know, once you sign 49 films, you're working for 3 films a day, 7 in the morning, yeah. 2 in the afternoon, 1 film, 2 to 10 at night, another, and 10 at night to 5 in the morning. Gratefully for me, Bhatt Saab used to keep that time for doing his films, you know, which I was doing Junoon, I was doing Janam. So he used to place all my shooting at night. And Pooja used to be the heroine in those films, and she used to be hating me. She said, you know, you've ruined our nights, because who bloody works at 10 o'clock at night to 5 in the morning? And Bhatt Saab used to be an insomniac like me, so he's quite happy working at night. So, you know, there was just no time. And I, you know, I used to travel around the globe, because those days you had the Bollywood nights, you had the actors' nights. So you had Rahul Roy, and I went all over the US and everything. And, you know, out of the 25,000 capacity, 40,000 capacity, or whatever the capacity was, 60-70% used to be girls. So, you know, I mean, as much as that, you know, for a 24-25-year-old guy, is like a big kick, you know, like, wow, I'm happening, I'm doing that. But, you know, when I used to shake hands with the fans or whatever, they used to be always burning up with fever. That was the kind of excitement that they had, you know. And as much as that used to give me a thrill, I used to get really scared, because I was not used to that, and I didn't know how to react. I mean, of course, you had to be sensitive, but at the same time, you know, I mean, the frenzy was so strong that it was so difficult to handle that. So you had all these people coming in from everywhere, and, you know, I had security at that time, we had bodyguards at that time, and they used to escort me to my suite, or, and in the hotel, inside the hotel room, there used to be girls and unclad, you know, waiting for me. We used to somehow manage to get into the rooms of these really high security five-star hotels. You know, how they used to manage, but they used to be there, and they had to be, you know, escorted out and things, because I didn't want to get caught up with all this stuff, you know, which was there. But having said that, the frenzy was unbelievable. And what actually is very, very unbelievable for me, Jamie, is that we are 30 years down the line with this film. And I have, you'd be shocked, the amount of, now they are women. You know, they've sent me photographs on my various social media. You know, like in 1997, I met you, and then there's a boom, there's a photograph. There's that. So the kind of fans that we in the 90s managed, I think we were very blessed, because those kind of fans have been very loyal. You know, they're very loyal. They're really wanting their childhood crush or hero come up and do up with some good work. And I've stayed away from cinema for 9 years, because I shifted to Australia, Sydney, and I couldn't do it. But now that my films are coming out and things like that are coming out, so they're all eager to this thing. But, you know, there are two things. It's like I'm kind of scared for that, because they have seen me more like, you know, playing different roles, being unconventional, but still being the romantic hero. And the kind of cinema which is there today is very, very different. It's no longer that kind of cinema, you know? So it's very real, it's very gritty, it's very brutal. The romance is more brutal today than what it used to be in those days, you know? So everything is really in your face. So, you know, I'm just preparing everybody through my various social pages and everything that, look, I know I've done some great work with some really good directors, and that's the direction I want to go in cinema. But I sincerely hope that you are able to accept me and not just carry the memory of that, you know, because that is a very tricky thing for, because, you know, that that kind of, whether it's an addiction or whether it's some kind of a thing, it's very, very difficult for them to get rid of, really tough. So I'm hoping for all that, but I'm also, I feel very blessed at the same time, Jamie, that I never knew that I had that kind of fan following. I never knew that people, you know, still loved it. And every time I felt that, you know, maybe I don't have that much going for me, it's really the fans who encouraged me and, you know, just been there and shown up in sheer numbers. And therefore, as we work in a market where you yourself are a commodity, so you need to have those numbers backing, because that increases your chances of doing work. So, people say, you know, aap to aashiqui ke naam se jaane jaate hain. And I, you know, like sort of in a very funny way. And I said, you know, there are other heroes who got 10 hits. Got 10 hits and they've done remarkably well. And nobody's taking that away. But to tell you very, very honestly, my one hit has been enough for a lifetime. So no matter how many hits I may give or I do good performances, I'm stuck with this monkey called Aashiqui on my back. But I'm proud to be that. You know, I'm really proud to have that. Yeah. So it's been a blessed life. And even though I've gone through some tough times, I won't say struggle, this, that, you know, because those are very dramatic words. And all of us who are part of cinema, part of this whole journey, we know that it's never going to be a smooth sailing thing. You're going to have your huge rough patches. But you better love your craft. You better love cinema. You better love what you do so much that irrespective of the consequences, you just want to be part of good projects and you want to love doing what you do. I feel on so many levels blessed that I carry on doing things that I want to do. You know? It's a great journey, Yaar. And, I will eternally be grateful that somebody like Bhatt Saab went against the tide, never asked me, you know, change your hairstyle, do that, do this. Because perhaps if he had done it, I might have done it also, Jamie, because I didn't know any better.
Yeah, correct.
You know, and why try and sound arrogant 30 years down the line because it worked? But he never changed. He never told me, do this, do that. He just wanted that Rahul role. And I'm so glad. And therefore, you know, when any newcomer comes to me now and talks to me and asks anything, I said, you know, follow your gut instinct, follow logic, you know, don't listen to people's, I've been in cinema 30 years, I've been in cinema 40 years. I said, with all due respect, anybody who claims that he or she knows what is happening and what is going to work, you got to be careful of them because they really don't know what's happening at all. There's no problem. It's been good, yeah. I'm happy.
It's so nice to hear you articulate your thoughts in that way. I remember shortly after the film came out, like I said, I was a kid, but you often hear what your parents are talking. And I remember my father and mother, because my mom was not into films at all, despite being my father's wife. But he was saying he had not seen that kind of female adulation since the Rajesh Khanna days. So just to pick up on that, you mentioned, you know, how you had all these fans. But where did you go to? Was there a personal private space you had where you could switch off despite all this madness? Because I can assume it would be very, very important to keep your sanity during these times.
Jimmy, I think Bhatt Saab saw that in me, you know, when he met up with me. I'm very open saying a lot of things, but I'm not somebody who plays the martyr syndrome or the martyr kind of thing. I came from a family which was divorced. I came from a family where my father was an alcoholic. Okay? And they got divorced when I was 12. But even in that scenario where it was very hurtful, traumatizing, I cannot once say that my parents were not fantastic with us. Both my brother, I have a twin brother, that they did not take care of us. You know, they gave us a lot more than probably a lot of children are privileged with. You know, they sent us abroad for studies, they never put restriction, but at the same time, there was a sense of discipline. They made us follow our heart with sports. So therefore, as Dad knew, we played cricket at a very high level. We were national swimmers, we were doing. So, you know, everything was given. But you know, when you lead that kind of a life, to upar se tumko sab kuch mil raha hai. But in the inside, there are huge things which, the parental love, the father's strong hand and the love, all that was missing. And at the same time, when I was modeling, that time there weren't that many male models. There were only four male models, and there were 25 in what honestly used to be supermodels, not what is claimed now. You know, today we do our own branding, we do our own packaging, we all call ourselves celebrities, we call ourselves superstars, and this, that. All the adverbs that are possible, everybody puts them in, and that's fine, irrespective whether the public recognizes them or doesn't recognize them. But anyway, that's the way it is today. But I was always surrounded by beautiful looking women, you know, really exotic, gorgeous, everything. So at the same time, I surrounded myself that time, like my mom was there, my brother was there, a couple of friends, schoolmates, classmates. And, when they've known you since you're 12 and you're 13 and all, they really don't care whether you're a superstar or not. They're not in awe of you. They treat you the same way as they've always treated. So, you know, I hung out with those people as much as I hung out even with the actors and everything. But I always had fine, that's a profession. I act. And I also know that, you know, I've been given this blessing that people love me so much and they made me into a superstar and blah, blah, blah. But I never wanted to lose myself. I didn't want to lose who I was, who I wanted to grow up into and things like that. And I think that has worked for me so beautifully in these last 30 years and continue. And that has helped me evolve more at a spiritual level. It has made me evolve because I realized that all these ups and downs are, you know, transitory, that it's not going to happen all the time. But if you remain somebody decent and good, essentially, the world will always give you an opportunity. And you know what is really funny is now I'm remembering, my second or third film, I was doing a film with Adhikari Brothers, that was the first feature film called Mukam. I was playing a cop.
Yes, yes.
Jitendra sir was acting in that. And I remember so beautifully that he told me that, he said, Rahul, there can be great actors. This country has some amazing actors, but they're lousy human beings. They will not get work. They will not get work in the long run. You can be an average actor, but just be a good human being. Somebody will always come to you with a project. And it just takes that one correct project to make things happen. So, you know, these things have been very, very important for me. And, you know, that sort of cemented my ideology of the way I was brought up at home and, you know, things like that, that pehle insaan to bano, phir ye sab cheeze karo, you know. And it's really strange. I went in for a preparation for a movie which I did with, I think, one of the most remarkable directors of recent times that I've worked with, called Kannu Behel. We just sort of finished a film called Agra, which is, I'm telling you, this movie is going to shake people literally in their roots. And the kind of stuff that I've been privileged to do with the team that I've been privileged to do. But kudos to the guys who prepared all us actors and prepared me. They spent a lot of time with me. And the one thing, you know, it's ironical. They said, I had to unlearn a lot of techniques and a lot of things and then relearn the new way of putting myself out there as an actor. But the one line that was essential is, actor to baad mein bano, pehle insaan to bano. You know? So there are all these things, you know, I mean, and it's, you see a lot of people that, get lost when they get into this profession. And it's all got to do with here. You know, they're completely lost. You ask them, like, what do you want to be? And most of them will say, you know, I want star, because I want to become a star. And, you think about it on a deeper level. That means you want money, you want fame, you want power, you want all these things. I look at them and I say, you know, this guy is not going to last. You know, even if he gets that stardom, it's going to go, then what? He doesn't have the tools, or she doesn't have the tools to handle this profession per se. I think it's more important that you be an honest actor, have that junoon of doing that kind of thing, taking some risk, but enjoying most importantly, challenging yourself. Most importantly, you've got to challenge yourself in this profession. Not be scared whether it's going to work or not, but whatever work you're doing, be convinced in what you're doing, you know? And if you get all these things, the public will make you a star. Everybody will make you the star. And whatever else that comes with being a star, all those perks are going to be there. So I never fell into that trap. And therefore, no matter how hard the knock was or how hard anything was, you know, I never went into like became an alcoholic, depressive. You know, I never went into all that, fortunately. And, you know, this is what I want to try and tell to a lot of the kids that are coming in now. They're doing this kind of work because they're so used to getting everything according to a certain timetable. They're so used to getting everything within a certain time frame. And they give up so quickly, or, you know, they get disheartened very quickly. But life doesn't work like that. It's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. You've got to, you know, be in this for the whole hog. जैसे पुराने जमाने में जब शादी होती थी तो यू नो अच्छा चल रहा नहीं चल रहा कुछ नहीं, बट ट्राई टू मेक द मोस्ट आउट ऑफ इट एंड मेक इट वर्क, नॉट लाइक ओके
निकलो।